everything.
A very good evening to everyone. Hopefully, am I audible to everyone? If any one of you can reply back, any of the attendees, if attendees can reply back, if I'm audible or not in the chat box. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Pinaki. Thank you, sir. All right. So, very good evening to everyone. Today we have a very special guest with us. But before we start, I want to share a few things about today's session. What is the session all about? A bit about the session. Our today's session is about how to manage COVID during winters with Dr. Gaurav Jain. COVID-19 likely to be more lethal as winter approaches. So the novel coronavirus that has traversed winter, spring, summer, monsoon, and now creating havoc in autumn has proven to be an all-season virus that is currently spreading rapidly in India. Sharing more details on this topic, we have Dr. Gaurav Jain with us. A bit about Dr. Gaurav Jain. Dr. Gaurav Jain is working as a consultant in internal medicine at Dharamshila Narayana Super Speciality Hospital, Delhi. He has worked with many hospitals of national repute. Before we take the session forward, I would request the participants to please use the chat box for any questions you may have. And we all will be taking up the questions at the end of the session. With these words, the stage is yours, Dr. Gaurav. Dr. Gaurav, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Anita. So I hope I'm audible. My video is not on. So what I'll be doing is I'll start sharing my screen. And just let me know if you guys can see it.
I think, Dr. Gaurav, it's visible. Any of the participants can also reply back if it's visible or not. Yes, it's visible, Dr. Gaurav. We have received a response also. So you can take this.
I'm not going to be boring. I'm not going to go over the same old stories that you have heard for almost a year now regarding what is corona and why it's troublesome and what it does. But a few basics are definitely needed to actually begin to understand why corona is such a big deal. And what have we learned over the last year? What have we understood about it? And this time, coming winters, how can we do better? How can we prevent ourselves from getting sick? How can we protect ourselves? And what can be done now that we have about a year of experience with the disease? There's a few disclosures that the data I'm giving you is basically sourced from WHO, ICMR, and the international guidelines. And so basically understanding what is COVID. COVID-19 is a viral aerosol. It is a small little virus that gets aerosolized when you talk, when you cough, when you sneeze, even when you actually might be just blowing your nose. And it basically enters the mucosa, which is the mucous membranes through which it causes disease, inflammation, and coagulation. So it is not just an infection that actually goes in and causes inflammation like a normal flu does. It actually causes inflammation in the blood vessels, clotting, and those are the two complications that actually lead to a lot more trouble. What are the symptoms? The symptoms can be like the common cold. The symptoms can be like pneumonia, can be like just being exposed to the cold, wherein you get body pains, headaches, generalized weakness. You can get cough. The stomach can be upset. You can get loose stools. You can get chest pains. You can get cardiac discomfort. You can get red eyes. You can get ear pains. You can get altered sensorium. You can get inflammation in the brain. So the symptom set keeps on growing. And what we are talking about is how to keep yourself safe as much as you can and what to do if you do get it. So COVID-19 is caused by the SARS coronavirus 2. It was first described in China, Wuhan, and like the SARS and the MERS, alpha coronaviruses cause everyday flu. It is a droplet infection, and these viruses, unlike the COVID-19, have been around for centuries. And in terms of history, well, it has had a progressive course in our country, but after the second and third waves, which we faced during the Dashera and post-Diwali, almost a crore cases in India have been reported. We have a fairly good recovery rate. We have lost a lot of people. We have had a lot of complications. But looking at the way we are going, we might soon become the world leader. And we are currently ranked 3 in the world. And let's see how it goes from there. It's up to you and me. It's up to us to see if we can actually stop and slow down this graph. Winters are a bad season, primarily because of the fact that, you know, we develop a lot of other symptoms which can mimic corona. And due to just that, we tend to actually neglect the disease a lot more. We tend to give a little bit of body pain, little bit of headache, little bit of running nose, that extra day or two to resolve. And that is why the spread of the virus can actually be more accelerated during winters. Another thing that actually winters do for the virus is the fact that you have less sun, you have less high temperatures. So metal surfaces, stone, you know, things outside, they do not get sanitized that quickly on their own. And that allows you to come in contact with the virus more often. So talking about the symptoms, as discussed, they can be tiredness, they can be dry cough, they can be difficulty in breathing, or moderate to high grade fevers, which usually begin all of a sudden. The other symptoms are loss of taste and smell. Now the reason behind this is actually noted as that this coronavirus seems to have a particular propensity for certain nerves. And the fact that smell and taste are the first nerve openings that it does come in contact with seems to suggest that people who have a loss of taste and loss of smell early usually are the ones who will have some kind of neurogenic irritability. Gastric upsets, this is when people who have throat infections tend to swallow those secretions, leading to infections in the stomach. You can have vomiting, you can have diarrhea, you can have pain, you can have bloating. And there is inflammation of blood vessels, which can cause poor blood flow in your peripheries, in your lungs. It can have blood clots, you can have heart attacks, you can have brain strokes. And we're getting a variety of problems with this disease. But then there are asymptomatic people as well. And that is one of those biggest conundrums of this disease, that, you know, these people will test positive. They might not show symptoms, they might not have fever, or they have so mild symptoms that they do not treat themselves or feel that they need any kind of medication. And they are good people. They develop a lot of the herd immunity we talk about. They do not have fatigue, they do not have exhaustion, and they are less likely to transmit the infection. But the fact is, since they are not quarantined, they tend to be the ones which carry the infection the most. Children among these are the most contagious people. So it is usually what we find is that the kids, the people below 14 years of age, they have a good lung capacity. They have a higher rate of regeneration of cells in their nasal linings, and they do not often show a lot of symptoms. But these kids tend to be unhygienic. They tend to rub their noses in places. Their hands are not clean all the time. And they are the ones that bring in infections into houses. They are the ones that get a lot of people inside the house infected. So what can you do to protect yourself? Well, the first basic rules that we talked about still stand. Wash your hands with an alcohol-based sanitizer or soap and water. With an alcohol-based sanitizer, you need to wait for the alcohol to evaporate. It is not the alcohol itself which is killing the virus. It is the act of evaporation which actually denatures its surface. So wet hand with alcohol on it is not sanitized unless it is dried up. Or soap and water for at least 25 seconds. Keeping a distance of around 2 meters or 6.5 feet between yourself and other people around you might not always be possible, but if available, you can try. Do not touch your eyes, nose, and mouth with your hand. Now, the best way I find to do that is by wearing gloves. You know, it's the fact that you have wearing gloves is a constant reminder when your hand goes near your mouth that you should not touch it. Cover your mouth and nose with a bent elbow, wear a mask or a handkerchief so that your aerosols do not spread. And when in doubt, ask. Doctors, local authorities are all there and we are willing to help. Just make sure that you do not delay and do not persevere in thinking that, you know, unnecessarily, let me not ask. It's always better to ask. And even though your doctor might tell you that you do not have the symptoms, it's always good to know that. What do offices or public places, what do you think these places can do? Well, the first thing that we recommend is automatic contact-free dispensers for sanitizers and tissues. Tissue is also important primarily because of the fact that sanitizers are usually just spread onto the hand. With tissues, you can actually use that same sanitizer, spread onto your mouth, spread onto your feet and other areas that need cleaning. Follow a clean desk policy. Make sure that everyone wipes their own desk and sanitizes the desk before they begin the day and at the end. Gloves and masks, shoe covers should be easily available. Good masks, proper masks, not the regular 3-ply masks that you get in the market, because a mask also needs to have 3 separate layers. The outer layer needs to be hydrophobic while the inner layer needs to be hydrophilic. What that means is the outer layer can be silk, the inner layer can be cotton, and there needs to be an absorptive layer in the middle so that, you know, your secretions stay in the mask, the other secretions are repelled from the mask, and that is what an ideal mask is. Not the cloth mask that you get in the market, not the usual mask that your a lot of these companies are selling you in the market these days. I guess we are doing the encourage the digital communication between members. Space out breaks for water and restroom breaks and prepare for emergencies. A lot of these offices and people I talk to do not have this. They do not have emergency bays. They do not have a contingency plan. If a patient or if somebody shows symptoms inside the office, what do they need to do? So a little bit of common sense and understanding is needed on both parts. Not everything can be done by the staff and not every office can achieve all the goals. But a little bit of common sense and diligence and you will be able to control things. Just a reminder, stay at home if you do not feel well. If you have mild symptoms, make sure to ask a doctor. He might prescribe some medicines and tests, and please get them done on time. Time is very important. A late test means that you are not yourself are putting yourself at risk, but others around you. Make sure that when you're going out, wear a mask and rubber gloves to minimize the risk of infecting yourself and others. And when you reach home, make sure that you disinfect. I'm not asking you to sanitize with a sanitizer or something. Just make sure that you take off the outside clothes, keep them in a separate place. Take a little bit of soap, wash your face if needed, and wash your hands. How to wear a mask? Now, that is another complication that we have found that most people do not seem to follow. Well, before wearing a mask, sanitize or wash your hands. Use a proper 3-ply mask as I discussed just earlier. It should neither be too tight or too loose. It should cover your mouth, the bridge of your nose and your chin. The reason is that this entire area is where most of the air entry happens and it should remain covered even with your mouth open. So you should be able to talk while wearing the mask without the mask coming off. Try not to touch the mask after wearing it. Do not rub your face or your nose without re-sanitization before and after doing so. replace the mask as soon as it gets wet. And in case you're using a disposable mask, don't try to save that 3 rupees. Buy a new one or get a new one. When you're removing a mask, do not remove it from the front. Do not pull it down from the front as most people I see do. Pull it down from behind the ear and throw it away, ideally in a closed container, and then wash your hands. So in winters, the good thing that we have is most people wear full sleeve shirts, full sleeve dresses. You are more protected in terms of that. You are advised to wear glasses if you have them, sunglasses if you want to, instead of lenses if you are required to. Get your own cutlery, get your own food, get your own bottle. That's something that, if possible, will be very, very helpful in keeping you safe. The clean desk policy we already talked about. If possible, use your own garbage bags. This is not something for everyone, but I guess the guidelines do mention this. This is more of an international thing, but probably using your own garbage means that you're not putting the sanitization workers at risk. If you do not have a waterproof phone, or if you are concerned that your phone might be affected, get a cover that can be sanitized. Wireless headphones are a good thing these days. Limited use of perfumes and makeup that reduces irritation on the nose, and a good diet. A rich diet in proteins, especially vitamin C, lots of liquids and proteins, boosts your immunity, keeps you away from a lot of symptoms, and keeps you disease free. Certain things that bigger offices can do, as we talked about, make sure that they properly located sanitizer dispensers at points of entry exit near the washrooms, the pantry, and the storage. That is where most of the common contacts happen. There are something called HEPA 2 filters which you can get for your AC inlets. They need to be changed every 36 hours or so, or at least sanitized after 36 hours or so, but they can actually filter out the virus in the circulation. Sanitizers, masks, gloves, as I said, should be available to the staff, and a demonstration needs to be held in most places so that people know how to wear them. We do get a lot of people coming in wearing masks, wearing gloves inside the hospital, but a lot of times when asked to show how they wore it or how they keep themselves sanitized, their ways are very wrong. Temperature screening, Aarogya Setu app, pool testing is something that has now come in. This is basically what we do, is that instead of individually testing all the employees, let's say you have a team which consists of 10 people, and instead of doing a test for all 10 people, spending that amount of money might not be feasible all the time. What is usually done is that a swab from all the people is taken, put into a single test, and then run. If the test is positive, then you know that one of the people, or probably the entire group which was in contact with each other, is positive. Versus if the test is negative, you can actually safely discount 10 or 15 people at a single test and a fraction of the cost to actually avoid doing unnecessarily tests and unnecessarily waiting times. And now coming to the fact that we are now going to live with the coronavirus. Despite the vaccine talk, despite the fact that, you know, we say that we will overcome it, we might get to a stage where we're not worried about it, but yes, we are still going to be living with the coronavirus for the years to come. The same is the case with swine flu. There was a lot of noise around it. The same is the case with dengue. That yes, we have now learned, we have now developed some degree of immunity, we are now more educated as to how to handle it. We are better at diagnosing it early, we are better at treating it early, and we know what works, what doesn't work. Same thing will happen with corona, but the virus is not going anywhere. There may be vaccines, there may be treatments, there may be new drugs which will become available. The mortality and the noise around it will die off, but the virus will not. So the idea is keep yourself healthy. Stay fit, eat fresh, have a good dose of sunlight and good amount of liquids in winters. That is very important to keep yourself safe. So why does everybody say that winters are bad for the coronavirus? Well, there are five factors which can actually lead to the fact that, you know, your infectivity rate goes up. The first is clothes. In winters, we tend to wear the same jacket, the same sweaters, the same outdoor clothes multiple times. You might say you don't, women might say that they change it, but in the end of it, that same jacket is going to be inside your house and outside numerous times before it goes to dry cleaning or it gets cleaned. And that is one very prominent area of infection that can carry an infection inside the house. So make sure that you have a good separate hanging place for your outdoor clothes. You do not need to spray sanitizer on them. You do not need to sanitize them all the time. Just be a little bit careful. Make sure that you're putting on your mask before wearing your outside jackets, which are the ones which are a big culprit. The second thing, as I said, because you're not getting enough sun, you're not drinking enough liquids, you tend to be moderately dehydrated. You tend to be moderately more prone to developing infections. The third reason is, as I said, the surfaces outside, the metals, the stones, the areas where you actually go down to sit, they do get cleared up on their own. A temperature of 30 degrees, the virus tends to stay on a plastic or a wooden surface for about a day or day and a half. At the current 10 degrees or 7 degrees Delhi is now facing, your virus can stay for up to 3 days. So that's about three times longer a period of infectivity on that surface. So you need to be careful. The other thing that actually does affect the fact about the virus is the fact that you are not more infective in terms of the virus transmission, but you tend to have symptoms longer. So people who have a little bit of cough, cold, tend to stay indoors, tend to stay in-house rather than show a doctor, thinking it's just common cold, thardi lag gayi hai, thand hai, thandi mein nah liye hai, and all those things. And you can actually come to a situation wherein the disease has progressed, you have infected the entire family before you actually come to the hospital. So the number of cases spike up because of that. Again, we have learned that, you know, Indians never understand social distancing. We started getting a spike in the number of cases at Navratri in Delhi. It peaked up at Dashera, stayed high till pre-Diwali times when it was starting to come down, and then Diwali and the function started. People moved about, met people, and there were numerous infections. Again, till the time it was Chhat also, the number of infections stayed high. But after about two and a half weeks, now we are getting another reduction in the number of cases. Let's hope New Year's celebrations and other functions and other marriages that people are attending does not become another reason for a spike. So basic thank you to the basic presentation of PATH. Another thing that we can actually talk about, I think, which I have not included in this, is the vaccines. I think a lot of people have questions about vaccines. A lot of people have doubts. A lot of people have a bit of misinformation about vaccines. So the first thing first, you need to understand that yes, vaccines are coming. Yes, vaccines have efficacy in developing immunity to the virus. No, vaccines are not treatments for an acute viral illness. And even if you take a vaccine today, it takes about 2 to 3 weeks for your body to develop immunity. So it's not as if you take a vaccine today and by tomorrow you can do anything you want or you are free to move about. It takes 3 weeks. You need 3 weeks of precautions and a test after taking the vaccine to confirm that you have formed antibodies. What are the vaccines available? Well, you have Indian brands. You have brands which are available through international firms like AstraZeneca and Pfizer, both of which are now under US FDA approval guidelines. You have brands from Russia like Sputnik, you have Chinese vaccines which are now available, and then there are certain research molecules which are in phase 2 and phase 3 and might be wonder drugs, might not be. We don't really know. As of now, the data that we have is pretty limited in terms of what we have. And we can see that, you know, there are cases reported where people have side effects because of the vaccine. There are cases reported wherein people who have had vaccine have had infections. We are getting patients who are now reinfected in the sense they had the early phases of infection and this has been 3 and 4 or maybe 6 months down the line and they have come back to us with a reinfection of corona. So it's not as if they are maintaining antibodies or they are maintaining immunity to this disease for a very long period. So there are a lot of questions associated with the immunity part of this thing. So the best precaution is still that you do not get infected. If you have sustained this long without getting infected, why not another 3 months? Let us get the data for the vaccines. Let us have a better opinion as to what works, what doesn't work. And maybe by that time, we will have a little bit of a better treatment approach as well. So there are a few new drugs which are in the pipeline, which should also be then available. So the best incentive I can give you to stay healthy is the fact that the longer you wait it out, the better treatment options you'll get. Thank you. So let's open this up to questions.
Yeah. If anyone has got any queries, anything they want to ask, you can please mention your queries in the chat box. Someone has written, is it safe to move? Move as in, if you can little bit elaborate.
I can say is it safe to move out? Well,
yeah.
You have to be careful. That's the only answer I can give you. You can't be stuck inside the house.
Safe to move with team, he has written, doctor. Is it safe to move with team?
Well, if your team has been tested, as I said, you can do a pool testing or you can do make sure that the same team is with you for the last 10, 15, 20 days. Then yes, I mean, it's not a bad idea. You know everybody else. Being face to face doesn't really matter as long as you're all safe.
Doctor, there is one more question. Is it safe to move to other place or city? I think it's a, maybe if you can answer, it's a repetition although, but.
You can move to another place, you can move to another city. The whole point is that, you know, when you get there, what kind of precautions are you maintaining? It's not, the travel part is not what probably will infect you unless you are traveling by public transport. It is the fact that when you get there, you need to reset, you set up a house, or maybe you are coming in contact with new people, people you do not know. That is where you can get infections. That is the most common point of contact. And if you can overcome that, maintain that safety in that period, then I don't think there's a problem.
One panelist has asked which mode of travel is more safe.
Well, as I said, if you can travel privately, have your own car or have your own vehicle, I guess that's the safest way to do things. If you're traveling by public transport, if you choose a mode which has less number of people in it, again, that's a safer option, gives you less chances of coming in contact with other things. And the other point would be, I guess, air travel, because the duration of contact is reduced. So if you compare a long distance travel via flight or via train, I would suggest air is a better way, primarily because the duration of contact and there is a better maintenance of the wearing of mask and shield in the flights compared to what you get on trains.
Doctor, there is one more question by a colleague of mine, wherein he is asking, wearing a mask, is it enough or do we require a shield too?
Shields are actually not really required by the general public unless until two things. One is that the mask that you're wearing is not as per the guidelines. So if that is the case, then yes, a shield is actually an additional protection. But if you're wearing a guideline recommended mask and you are capable of not touching your face, then a shield is not really needed.
That's true. You have told us I think there were 3-4 points wherein you have guided us how to wear a mask also. So I believe if that will be followed, then I believe naturally the person will be safeguarding himself or herself only if the rules or the steps will be followed. Any other queries? Any other queries if anyone want to ask anything else? Okay. Okay, there is one more question. Is it true that he has written, is it true that we heard in the news that if the vaccine is given to health workers, the chain will break?
What kind of chain? The chain of transmission? Well, no, not really. Most of the workers actually come in contact with the disease through patients. And the fact is, if you give all health workers the vaccine, you will realize that almost more than 60 to 70% of health workers in your hospital today have already had the disease. They have had it clinically or subclinically, and antibody testing in the hospitals have shown that most hospitals in the metropolitans, Bombay and Delhi, have a level of herd immunity, wherein more than 66% of the staff members are showing active antibody titers. So probably this news that you heard is wrong. And it's more important for actually the general public to be safe, for them to actually understand how the disease is progressing. And you cannot really break the chain by just vaccinating the healthcare workers.
Doctor, there is one more question. How can one access about COVID-19 or normal fever due to temperature changes or cold?
Well, it's not that simple as to, it's not a single question or answer that can actually answer that. So it's more about a set of situations that you go through and the set of symptoms that you go through. So it's not like, you know, somebody who just has a normal cough and cold versus somebody who has COVID will actually have a lot of different present. It is just that, let's say you have a history of cold exposure, you have a history of maybe having a cold drink or an ice cream or going out for a walk at 10 in the night. You have a history of coming in, developing a runny nose, a cough and cold, a dryness, and then a fever, or the body ache preceded that. So those are small things that we actually you out, and that is what gives us an idea whether it is following the typical pattern of a regular old school viral disease versus it's different. If it is different, then there's a chance that this is COVID. We are still learning about this. It's not as if we have a very detailed, straightforward questionnaire that you can answer and say if this is COVID or not. Had that been the case, cases would have been very easy to identify. So it's actually based on the doctor's skill and their experience, which will actually help you to determine whether you're dealing with a case of COVID or just simple flu.
That's true. Another question is, in winters, precautionary, do we need to take any medicine to improve our immunity?
You don't really need a medicine if your diet and appetite and your fluid intake and your sun exposures are good enough. That's all pretty much you need. Even if you take a medicine, those medicines are pretty much nutraceuticals. You get vitamin C, you get a little bit of vitamin D. We ask you to have a slightly more protein-rich diet, and probably we give you a little bit of antioxidants. So those are all things that are available in your diet. Winters are good in the sense you will get a lot of green vegetables, you get a lot of good citrus fruits, which are, you know, the natural way of doing these things. You get a lot of protein that you can take. So that is the whole principle. You can get it through normal diet, you can get it through medicines, but the principle remains the same, that you know, you need to just boost up your immunity a little bit so that you remain healthy. Okay. I see another question there. In England. Well, honestly, this is not a new type of COVID in England, but we're getting a variant, which is again the same thing that we're talking about. It's more about reinfection. So we are getting a lot of cases wherein in the UK and now in India as well, where people are developing the infection again. And when people develop these infections again, you know that they have some degree of immunocompromise in the system. And a second infection can sometimes be very more lethal. Also, the fact that patients are developing this condition wherein they're not really showing symptoms early on. So there is a change in England that is being noted that people develop symptoms on around the 10th day of the disease, wherein that is not because of the virus itself. The virus is fairly quiet, but when your body starts fighting it, the immunity that's there to actually fight the virus, that seems to be damaging the lungs, that seems to be damaging the joints and the muscles, and that is what causes inflammation. And so antivirals at this time don't really work. The usual medicines that the Western practitioners have actually followed, like remdesivirs and favipravirs, and they don't work. What is actually working is steroids in that case, or what is working is HCQS in that case. So there's a difference of how things work in these cases. So that's probably the reason why there's a slight spike in the mortality, but it's not a dangerous type of COVID. It's just a slight variation that's there, and the medical society needs to adjust to that. Yes, you can meet a person who had COVID-19 earlier and has recovered. It's actually he's probably the safest person to meet, primarily because he for the next 3 months has antibodies, so he will not have the infection A, and he will not transmit any infection that he might have come in contact with from another people, because his antibodies will actually take care of any bug that he might have on him. So it's okay to meet them. What is not okay in winters, as I said, is that the person is safe, but their clothing, their contacts, in the sense their jackets, their sweaters, they might not be safe. They might still be infective. So still keep precautions. It's not as if everything is hunky-dory. It's not as if everything is safe on that front. Okay. Baba Ramdev. Anu Oil, Sorasi, and Coronel. Coronel is basically a multivitamin. Haldi, again, turmeric is an anti-inflammatory. So there's nothing wrong in taking them, but don't expect them to stop you from developing COVID. They boost your immunity to some extent. They reduce the inflammation you have to some extent. And most of the people, almost 80% of them, will tide over COVID without any complications or problems. And having these in your system will just keep you a little more comfortable. They do not prevent you from developing the infection.
I think that's it with the questions. Thank you so much, Doctor, for such a valuable piece of information for all of us. It was a great session altogether, wherein we were not aware about few things, and you have shared a list of things we got aware about. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everyone, to join the session. Thank you so much, Doctor. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.